Hi. So, I've been writing a novel for the past year about the Akkadian Empire. So the transition from Sumer to Akkadia in ancient Mesopotamia. And as sometimes happens, especially when you're writing historical fiction, you can fall down a rabbit hole of research and you just poof, you get lost. And something caught my eye whilst I was researching this, that has led me to a sort of a theory that could potentially be a complete crackpot theory. And I don't know, sort of, it could be levels of confirmation bias, all building up, or it could be something interesting. And so I thought I would do this little video and put it out there to see whether or not, anybody else who knows more than I do about this has anything to say. And what I'm focusing on is here in Rwanda, we have beautiful artwork called Imigongo. And this is traditional Rwandan artwork made from cow poo, so cow dung artwork. And it's said that it was traditionally, it was in the magical huts, so I suppose sort of traditional healers and so forth. But I'm going to go into the history a bit more later on. But what kind of really caught my attention was when I started to research the ancient city of Uruk in Mesopotamia. Now you might have heard if you watched my video about the history of creative writing, you might remember Uruk is the place where Gilgamesh was set. So Gilgamesh was the king of Uruk. He was a legendary figure, and the legend of Gilgamesh is the oldest surviving work of great literature that we know of. And I'm just going to show you what specifically caught my attention. And then I will go off down my theory and explain it to you. And you can tell me if it's a pile of pants and wishful thinking or whether there might be something to it, because I'm genuinely fascinated by this topic. So, this is what I found. Okay, so my story begins in modern day Iraq, in an area called Mesopotamia, which I believe was the Greek for the area between the rivers, because it sat between the Tigris and the Euphrates. And it's also called the Fertile Crescent, because this is where it's believed that we started to make the transition from nomadic hunter-gatherers into an agricultural society. And we're concerned with this little place down here called Uruk. Now, Uruk, under several both Sumerian and Akkadian kings, was a very, very important town. So this is an artist's impression by Jeff Brown Graphics, and it just sort of brings it to life a little bit. So at its height, at around 2900 BC, there were perhaps 80,000 people living in the city, which doesn't sound like a lot by today's standards, but in those days, with such a low population, it was a major hub of activity. And it was right down near the southern coast, so it had trading access to many other parts of the world. So I just got to this part in my story where my main character turns up at Uruk to have a discussion with the king. And during my research, I discovered or I stumbled across something called the Cone Temple at Uruk. Now, I'd never heard of this before, and I thought, oh, that sounds interesting. So I went to look it up on Google, and when I saw it, my jaw pretty much hit the floor. So this is a black and white image of the Cone Temple at Uruk. And what absolutely knocked me sideways is it just to me, it looks exactly like Rwandan Imigongo. And I mean exactly like it. So I've transposed some traditional Imigongo patterns next to the Cone Temple pillars, and you can see what I mean. I mean, to me, That similarity was particularly striking, is that all three of those pillars have an exact sort of pattern replica in Rwanda, and also, you know, the preferred colors of black and white, although this is a black and white photograph, and I will go into that in a moment. So these are some pictures of some Imigongo that I've got in my own home. And again, you can see the striking similarities of the black and white geometric shapes. And this is Top View Hotel in Rusizi in southern Rwanda. And this is just the reception area as you walk in. So you can see that people are still very proud of Imigongo. It's a very much a national art form, pretty unique to Rwanda. I mean, I haven't seen it in Uganda or Kenya or DRC, so it is considered to be quite uniquely Rwandan. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that it was a black and white photograph, and the part that then just got stranger for me is that this is a colour photograph to contrast, and you can see that the colours of the temple are white, black, and red. And the reason it's called a cone temple is because the colours are put into the wall using coloured cones. So it's a bit like a mosaic. And what really just struck me and stood out at that moment is the fact that, yes, today you most commonly see black and white Imigongo, but traditionally, as this modern reconstruction shows, it was black, white, red, and grey. And so red was an integral part of traditional Imigongo paintings. Now, of course, at that point, I'm thinking, well, you know, geometric shapes, they are beloved around the world by most cultures. I mean, take a look at this. This is a Norman church in the English village of Quennington, and you can see quite easily how much the Normans enjoyed geometric shapes. And many of them, like the zigzag and the diamond shape, are identical to what you would see in Imigongo. So, you know, around the world, people loved geometric shapes. And here we can see another example from the Aztecs, who absolutely loved geometric patterns. So I know that you do have to be a bit careful. You can't just say, oh, these two things are alike and therefore they must be connected. Obviously, you can't. But the similarity was just so striking. And everybody I showed it to here and I said, where do you think this building is? And they all said it has to be Rwanda because, you know, that's Imigongo. And it's like, yeah, it is so similar. So then I began to think about whether or not there was the potential for a link. Given how striking the similarity was there any opportunity for there to be a crossing of artistic culture? So naturally, my mind went to migration, and I was thinking maybe up over the top of Egypt and down, as in ancient Egypt, around 3000 BCE, just before they began building pyramids, it appears that the Egyptians might have started by trying to build Sumerian-style ziggurats. So ziggurats are like pyramids, but they have steps instead of being straight lines. However, the other option, which is to go through what is today Yemen and Djibouti, also seemed like a possibility. But I wasn't too sure. And things got a little bit stranger when my friend pointed me in the direction of Burkina Faso. So often, if you're Googling or you're looking through Twitter for information about Imigongo, you very regularly see people in Burkina Faso saying, oh, yeah, you know, it's the same influence. We've got this over here, you've got Imigongo over there, it's the same thing. And what's really interesting is that Burkina Faso does appear to have an extremely similar form of art. And there's a fascinating article from 2017 by Emma Taggart on Modern Met, where she actually got access to this village and was taking pictures, the village of Tiebele. And it is just incredible how similar some of these images are to sort of the black and white that we know from Imigongo. And I'll put a link to the full article below. It's really worth looking at. But you can see that it's a little bit less refined. So when you're looking at Imigongo, the lines are really, really precise. Whereas in the art that you see in Burkina Faso, there are definitely some very strong similarities. I mean, here's a great example. This column here on the left is definitely, you see that in Imigongo. You see the diamond shapes. And you also see this sort of triangular hatching along the top. But there are also some big differences. So in Imigongo, you don't see this sort of coffee bean shape or the stars. And when you get the kind of checkerboarding, it's usually diagonal in Imigongo. You don't usually see it as horizontal checker lines. So it's kind of similar, but different at the same time, but similar enough to be interesting, as in there might be a connection there. And the artwork in Burkina Faso really put me in mind of Ubaid art. So Ubaid was a civilization that existed in Mesopotamia before sort of the Sumerian Akkadian empires came into being. And as you can see, it's got a lot of the same kind of shapes. It's got the water shapes and the wave and the zigzag, and it's got the cross hatching, but it's a lot less precise than the later kind of Uruk cone temple or Imigongo images. And what is really interesting about this is that the cone temple was built on top of an older existing Ubaid temple. Now, there's some suggestion that it might have been a water temple or something related to water, but I'm not too sure about the facts of that. Now, obviously, this is just conjecture, but it could potentially signify an evolution of the artwork. So taking slightly imprecise, slightly more free expression and formulating that into something more formal, more structured, more exact in the cone temple that was built on top of it. Now, I am definitely going down the line of confirmation bias here, but there was just a lovely, lovely statement in the article that I just mentioned, where the reporter and the photographer, before they were allowed to go into the village to take these photographs, they were given a very strict dress code. And she says, "We were told in advance that we must not wear anything red and we may not carry an umbrella. Only the chiefly noble family is permitted that privilege, and to do so would constitute a great affront to our hosts." Now, this just kind of hit me a little bit, because when I started writing my novel, on the very, very first page of my notes, my notebook, I wrote down a quote that I found in one of the books, and I can't remember which book it was, but I will put some suggestions below. It was one of them. And it was an old Sumerian Mesopotamian saying, "When walking with the strong or the dead, do not wear clothes of purple or red." Because purple and red were considered to be sort of the colours of the nobility, of the kings, and related to rituals of the dead. Now, the interesting thing about the village in that article is that they say that some of the most beautifully decorated houses were actually mausoleums for the dead. So I just found it a really interesting kind of connection. Again, West Africa and Mesopotamia both saying the same thing about the colour red. Now, obviously, you know, the colour red is significant all over the world. You can't draw any conclusions from that, but it was just a really nice kind of oh moment. So anyway, this got me thinking about a few theories. The first and most obvious theory is sheer random chance, that two people in two different countries came up with a similar idea, and this certainly isn't the first time this has happened in the history of invention. So in Rwanda, the story about how Imigongo came to be is that Kimenye, the king of Gisaka, had a son called Kakira. Now, Prince Kakira lived in Kibungo province, and it is said that he was the first person to mix ash and clay for colour and to paint the inside of his house with Imigongo patterns. So it could just be that that was randomly developed and that's what he came up with, and that it has absolutely no connection whatsoever with Uruk. That is a perfectly acceptable explanation. Now, some of the sources that I've found suggest that this happened in the 18th century, and some say the 19th century. And I think what might have happened is somebody might have mistranslated 18th century to mean 1800s, which would mean that the 19th century would be correct and this happened in the 1800s. And other sources suggest that there were many King Kimenyes of Gisaka, and some of those stories even date back to the 1500s. So placing the exact time of this story in the invention of Imigongo is not so easy. And if anybody watching happens to know which King Kimenye it was, it would be fantastic if you could drop it in the comments. The second explanation I came up with is definitely the most outlandish one and the most improbable. But what I was thinking was that the cone temple at Uruk was discovered and excavated by Germans between 1912 and 1913. Rwanda was colonized by Germany during that time, and you know, the cone temple currently sits at the State Museum of Berlin. So I was wondering, given the proximity of Rwanda to Mesopotamia and the political ties at that time, that they were excavating in Uruk and also occupying Rwanda at the time, whether or not potentially an archaeologist from Mesopotamia might have been travelling home through Rwanda and potentially met Prince Kakira or somebody else in the local community, and the artwork became absorbed in the local community. However, the reason I think this is probably an unworkable scenario is because Uruk was completely abandoned to ruin by 700 AD, and then it wasn't excavated by the Germans until 1912. Now, if the previous story about King Kimenye was true, then that would have happened in the 1800s, if that dating is correct, and therefore nobody would have known about the Cone Temple at Uruk at that point. So I think we can probably discount this one, although it is a tantalising prospect. Which brings me round again to the most likely theory of migration, but I've kind of updated it now. Is I think that there may well have been two migrations. And one of the things that has slightly swung this for me is you can see where the little red marker is up near the Persian Gulf. Now that is next to an island which is today known as Bahrain. But Bahrain was called Dilmun in Mesopotamian ancient history. And Dilmun is largely considered to have been the inspiration, potential inspiration, for the Garden of Eden. The people of Dilmun and the people of a bit further north in what is today Iraq spoke a similar language. It was a Semitic language. And in a moment I'll show you why the language that they spoke in that region might give us a clue to the migratory pattern into Africa. But, and this is an entire bag of maybes, if we're going to potentially say that the Burkina Faso art is an earlier version of what we later got in the Cone Temple and then in Rwanda, then there may have been two migrations. An earlier one which went across Africa and a later one that came down through Africa. One of them bringing Ubaid art and the other bringing Sumerian art. Now, what I mean about the language is that Akkadians, who were living around the time that the Cone Temple existed and may have helped to transport this artwork out of Mesopotamia, spoke a Semitic language. And in modern day Ethiopia, you find people who speak Amharic, which is also a Semitic language. And below, I've included a link to a video which basically shows you how Akkadian travelled down through to the Horn of Africa and became Amharic. And I've also included a link to another video about the history of the Cushitic people, which were another language group which also travelled down from the Horn of Africa down to potentially South Africa. And there definitely is some evidence that there was a migration of people from the Horn of Africa right down to the very south of Africa. But we are talking about several thousand years ago, which is when the Akkadian Empire and the Sumerian Empire was at the height of its power, and when this sort of artwork could well have been exported around the world via the very vibrant trade routes that existed at that time. So when we're talking about the village of Tiebele, which is where the houses are painted in Burkina Faso, there's a wonderful piece of information about the Gurunzi, who are the people who live there. And they have an oral tradition. And in their oral story, they say that they originated from Western Sudan, which is closer to Ethiopia than it is to West Africa, and that they walked across, or they passed through, the Sahel. And that is basically travelling from east to west across to West Africa. And while it is unknown when the migration occurred, it is believed that they were in the current location by 1100 AD. Now, I never ever dismiss oral story tradition. And as I mentioned in my history of creative writing, some European fairy tales have been dated back as far as 5,000 years, some Australian oral stories as far as 7,000 years. So they can be quite an accurate depiction of where people came from. And so if their oral story is correct, then that would also lend some credence to the idea of a mass migration, potentially bringing their art with them. And there we have it. That is my theory of how Imigongo potentially got to Rwanda. And it might be complete fiction. It might be as fictional as one of my novels. But I find it a fascinating concept, a very interesting sort of idea. And I do think that, you know, often when we think about history, we think about people being set in one place and one empire, and they stayed there and they were born there, they grew up there, they died there. But I don't know, I think we were very, very mobile through most of history. You know, people were out discovering the world and we were doing fascinating things all over the place, thousands of years ago. So I don't think it's that implausible, but I would love to hear from some experts, some people who actually really know this subject better than I do, who know the history of art better than I do, and the history of the region. Because one of the big questions is, if it was migratory, why doesn't this art form exist in any of the other countries coming down from the Horn of Africa or going across? Now, going across, you're going through Sudan, you're going through Chad, and they're countries that have had quite a lot of upheaval and quite a lot of disturbance. So, you know, it wouldn't be surprising if art, especially art that went through there a few hundred or thousand years ago, has completely disappeared. But it's just strange because, like I say, Imigongo is so very specific to Rwanda. And it's just strange that there isn't anything else, sort of a trail, which would then kind of suggest that it was just independently created in Rwanda and that there is no link at all. I'd love to know.